Hello, my soccer universe. Well, it was not to be. But I have to say, the optimism for LASK playing at Spurs was never that high. I actually was not that optimistic about Milan either, but as we will see, they surprised me, hence I'm wearing Milan. Again, my two loves played this at the exact same time. I watched both of them, so I didn't see much of the other late games, saw a few goals. And yeah, I watched the goals on, and with an emphasis on young boys Roma on the first slot. But you know, that's exactly bad time for the kids and so on, so you need to. I'm not that all set for that either, to be honest, but hey. Well, let's start with Spurs LASK. I mean, you saw already my quick summary at the beginning of the video. Spurs was in every regard better. I had some hope when I saw the lineup, seeing that there's no Son, no Kane, and generally, you know, rather a second string squad. But then if you just have there Gareth Bale as a reserve player and Lucas Moura, who, you know, was largely responsible for the for them reaching the Champions League final, and Reguilón playing, there's no chance, there's absolutely no chance, and it didn't get better. That probably our most important midfield player with James Holland went out after 5 minutes. I mean, he was already injured prior, and yeah, he just couldn't, and in a way, I understand there's the temptation to let them play, but I actually think LASK probably should have thrown in the towel from the beginning a little bit, you know. The one thing I have to say before, they tried to play their game. They tried to press forward, and Mourinho afterwards said, yeah, that's exactly how I love them to play. Because that's where you can hit them with the speed. And every single Spurs player is faster than whatever LASK can muster up. And that was the big problem. Spurs did not go full on. They just second, third gear or whatever. And that was enough. I mean, and you could see, I mean, I think LASK could hold them at bay for about half an hour. It was not that there were many great chances, but you saw just Carlos Vinicius and Lucas, how they combined for the first goal. I think it was Winks who played the ball deep. And then they're just crossing, and Lucas sees the ball is not coming to him, because otherwise he would be offside. He goes into space, and the LASK defense is completely unsorted at that moment, because they're also pressing so high. I think right at the beginning, with some luck, they could have made a goal. But then it was all Spurs. There's no doubt about it. So I thought the first goal was nicely played by Spurs. The second one, Bale. What angers me there is that I think even Bale was offside, but the target of Bale was also offside, but Andrade needed to intercept. And this was two or three times where it was clear of sides, but LASK played himself out of position by a defender running back and intercepting the ball. When you could get a free kick, you're already in a pretty bad position. So here he didn't need to go there. And yeah, Bale crosses in, Andrade tries to intercept and puts it into his own net. And then a few seconds later, right off the kickoff, they could have made another one. Schlager actually not looking good there. But Schlager redeemed himself in the second half. LASK best chance, best phase was probably then a few minutes before the half, and especially Gruber had a great shot on goal at heart. It was not that hard of a save, but at least he had to extend himself. Second half, the LASK version is, we got a little bit more hold on the game, a bit more, made some adjustment, could make it more even. That is one side of the coin. The other side is that Spurs just went into management mode. And then the absolute scariest moment for me came in the 62nd minute. Heung-min Son, Sissoko and Dele Alli come on for Bale, Højbjerg and Lamela. At that moment I knew, yes, it's not going to end just 2-0, and Son in the 84th makes one. I was glad that they didn't turn on to make a really a route, because it was in there. But you know, it ended all friendly afterwards. And yeah, Spurs is clearly the best team, and as you can see, they are right now in the number one spot. I think I would even go so far, if they can stay healthy, that's a big if, But the quality that they have, I think Spurs actually could challenge this year for the Premier League, for sure in the Europa League. So let's talk about happier times, and that was Milan, who totally surprised me, to be honest. I did not expect much. I expected, but you know, this is the crowd factor, I think. If the crowd was there, the Celtic players would run forward and overextend. In the first half, Milan bossed Celtic around. Yes, they had this good start, but then whenever I looked, I mean, my focus was on Spurs LASK. But I looked over, I always thought, yeah, there were deep balls. Milan is kind of pushing Celtic around. Celtic doesn't know what they're doing. And, you know, Castillejo, a substitute. And that's the other thing. Milan played with a substitute team as well. And I totally get that. Give the other players a little bit experience. Let them get towards the squad. We have the first team squad for the league. There's a big game against Roma coming up. Do that and then see where this goes, and you can always make a few adjustments. And if you can play Tonali, the only thing is that there was a little bit that Ibrahimovic was playing, but I guess he demands some game time as well. But Ibrahimovic was not that much of a factor. It was mostly Theo Hernandez, but the first goal came from the right side, Casillejo crossing and Krunic. Yes, give him some time. He needs some time. He was not the, he could have decided the derby much sooner. Makes it 1-1 in the third for the second. I think it was a deep ball. Goes to Theo Hernandez, who then plays it to Brahim Diaz. But the two Celtic defenders collide after Brahim Diaz made a little wiggy. Puts him into internet, 42nd minute, 2-0. I thought, yeah, one is 2-0 up, the other was 2-2-2-0 down, so my face is like this. Celtic then came out. I could see that Celtic gave the Milan a little bit more trouble in the second half, and they get a goal through El Yunusi. But especially after Ibra came off, and then Kessié came on for Bennacer, so you keep Tonali on. Also, wasn't it interesting to see Laxalt play against Milan? I did not realize that he went to Celtic, so I thought this was cool because, I mean, I always liked Laxalt, but he was not a first-team player, so I hope he will have a good time at Milan. So El Yunusi, Norwegian, that was the other thing. It just does not compute, but I totally understand where it's coming. The Swedish referee at the last Tottenham game was Mohamed Al-Hakim. But, you know, I know that there are many immigrants there, and I'm fine with that part. It's just when you hear that in Sweden, it just doesn't compute. The same thing as El Yunus in Norway does not really compute, but hey, that's it. Then, two substitutions. Salah makers for Casillejo, Hauge for Brahim Diaz, kind of switching the sides a little bit, or the sides and the center around. Don't waste Çalhanoğlu, you have actually two. And yes, Celtic is pressing for the equalizer, but Milan could get a little bit of relief. I think after this 1-2, there were then a little bit more chances. And in stoppage time, it's Salamakers who plays a deep ball to Hauge, who can convert easily. And I was so happy for Hauge getting his first for Milan. And Milan plays at home, gets a win, and that's all that counts. Let's walk through the other games of the Europa League. I will highlight a few that I saw a little bit and give you the results of the other ones. I'm trying to get a picture of every game into this video. Young Boys against Roma was kind of, I'm torn because Young Boys, they have a relationship with LASK, but Roma is one of my favorite sides as well. So yeah, I was rather neutral. The Young Boys jersey, I remember when I was in Switzerland early, I also saw the front and thought, yeah, this is interesting with the black sleeves. But then again, this Nike thing with on the back, it looks different. Tottenham is having, this is a horrible idea. Clumsy challenge hands Young Boys a penalty that they convert. And I think Young Boys actually had could keep, again, second string Roma squad at bay. However, in the second half, Roma turned it around in a half and so with two really, really weird goals. Yes, it needed Mkhitaryan, Dzeko and Vera too coming on. And also Spinazzola. But the way that Dzeko then plays the ball to Perez and everyone is, you know, running towards Perez and he just tips the ball and it rolls easily into the net in the 69th. That was weird. And also the second by Kumbula seemed too easy. I have to say it this way. It seemed 2-2 easy. So Roma turns it around and gets a 2-1 win. And I think Group Cluj also beats CSKA Sofia 2-0, kind of expected. Dundalk had a lead over Molde, but Molde turns around in the second half in the same group. Same match film, except that it wasn't in the first half. Rapid actually was not that bad in the game. I was surprised that Arsenal shows up in blue. But then if you look at the Rapid jerseys, green, you know, the Arsenal looking green, more or less. I understood it, but you don't see many green versus blue matchups. Rapid took a lead because, or in the first half, the, you know, David Luiz and Leno kind of are always waiting to explode into some crazy craziness, and here they did. I mean, David Luiz plays to Leno, who plays it out to Karac, then Funtos can put it into the empty net. Arsenal then brings on Aubameyang, Bellerin again, playing with a second string squad, and within a few minutes, it's enough. Pepe sets up David Luiz after free kick, and then Bellerin crosses to Aubameyang, 74th, it's 2-1 Arsenal. Thereafter, maybe, after the 1-1, Rapid had a huge chance again with the defense of Arsenal not looking sorted. But, you know, Tottenham had a very professional win. Arsenal just got the job done, got a little bit in trouble with it, but they get the job done, and that's that. It hurts if you're a Rapid fan. I don't pity you, but other than that, it's all fine. From the Austrian point of view, yes, I don't like Rapid, but it seemed to be a little bit sad because there was a little bit more in there. Leverkusen rolling over Nice. I mean, it's 2-1 at the half, but already within 60 minutes, they were 2-0 up through Amiri and Alario. Guiri, the 31st, pulls it back, but the second half, Leverkusen all over Nice. Diaby, Bellarabi with the second one. Then Wirtz in the 87th and in the 90th, they can pull one back. I mean, this was really, really, really easy for Leverkusen. Something I did not expect. The other thing I did not expect, Harpal Beersheba beats Slavia Prague 3-1. It was 1-1 for a short period, but in the end, two late goals for Beersheba, played in Croatia, look, interestingly enough, get the win. Rangers win 2-0 at Standard de Liège, kind of expected Standard de Liège with weird jerseys. Benfica took the lead, got the equalizer, took the lead against through Nunes. Right after half, Lech can equalize, but then Nunes in the 60th and again, stoppage time, seal deal. So it was hard work for Benfica, whose jerseys, I have to say, this doesn't look like Benfica, but you know, I said that before. Then let's go to the PSV against Granada game. I think PSV was the better team in the first half and took even the lead through Mario Götze. Really, Dumfries, and then Götze just one times it, kind of. Was really nice shot, but in the second half, Granada turns it up and actually can turn around through Molina and Machis within 10 minutes, turn the game around, give Granada a pretty big win. I actually thought PSV will get something from them. PAOK, a rather disappointing 1-1. I mean, they were 1-0 down after 16th minute. Then Thomas Murk was set up by Schwab. I mean, two former Rapid players are now playing for PAOK. I guess I now have to a little bit like them more. But yeah, the Austrians make that, but PAOK cannot find the winner, which I have to say seems a little bit like dropped points there. The big surprise of the evening was Napoli not showing up and losing to Alkmaar in the 57th minute through David. That's the team that LASK beat. And everyone said, if there's one team that will for sure score goals with all the crazy attack they have, it will be Napoli. They did not maybe play now with the full, but still, Napoli, I don't get it. Didn't they take it full? The counts considering on the league, because if that's a serious count, as Napoli is rolling over Alkmaar. I'm 100%. Real Sociedad also gets a very late win at Rijeka, which ends the early games. Braga 3-0 over Ajax was more clear than I expected. But, you know, Leicester, Zorya is exactly what I said. Madison, Barnes and Iheanacho get the three goals. Also, easy win for Leicester. There, we talked Celtic, Milan already. Sparta against Lille was definitely helped that Sparta had a man sent off in the 23rd minute, stoppage time. First half, Lille gets the first goal. Sparta can even equalize right after half, but then Lille is just too much to handle. Yaziki, Ikone, and again Yaziki add three more goals, 65th. And Lille gets a big win as well. And as we'll see, Lille and Milan are very well set in this group already. Maccabi Tel Aviv 1-0 over Karabakh, okay, but craziest game of the evening, Villarreal against Sivasspor, something I did not see coming. After 20 minutes, Villarreal was 2-0 up. Coyote puts one back for Sivasspor, and Bakker misses a penalty, and just before the half, Yatabare makes it 2-2. Then, again, lead for Villarreal is equalized through Gradel in the 64th, and it is two Alcacer goals in the 74th and 76th for Villarreal to get this home dry. Spurs LASK we talked about. Ludogorets took a lead early in the second half, but Antwerp comes back to win it. Interesting, because that's a LASK group. Ludogorets is the next opponent, and LASK better beat Ludogorets if they want to stay in contention in their group here. Dynamo and Feyenoord play out a 0-0 draw. Yeah, Wolfsburg against CSK Moscow go down very soon. But a Lindl penalty after, you know, this was one where there was a chance, then it was cleared. Lindl plays it in, a foul, penalty 1-1. It was a good result, I think, for Wolfsburg, because the individual class of CSK is just better. Hoffenheim 2-0 over Red Star Belgrade, and Slovan over 1-0 over Ghent rounds out the Europa League fixtures. So let's look at the tables. And what has shaped with Cluj and Roma, of course, top of the table, with Roma now clearly favored. Young Boys still over Cluj. Arsenal, with that win, will go through. Molde is now favored over Rapid, but let's see how that will go. I think Rapid is playing away to Molde next, so that's a big match for them. Leverkusen, yeah, they will toy with this group as far as I see it. Let's see if Hapoel Beersheba can keep it up. Benfica and Rangers, great position here. Granada, yes, very good. I have to see PSV, PAOK and Omonia. I think it will be, I personally think it will be between PSV and PAOK. However, it's again, how serious do they take it? Napoli already in trouble. Now it's Real Sociedad who are favored to come out of this first in this group. But I still think Napoli should make it. But hey, I thought also they need to beat Alkmaar. So yeah, Gattuso needs to beat them a little bit. Leicester and Braga will go through in the first group. It looks like Lille and Milan. I think Milan winning at Celtic really calmed my feelings for the Europa League. Lille will be a tough opponent, though. But I think Milan will have at least enough to make it second. Villarreal, yeah, will go through. Maccabi Tel Aviv, Spurs, season through. It will be a three-way fight, and Antwerp now has a three-point lead over LASK, so not too happy about that. I would have rather seen a draw there, to be honest. Yeah, the next group is open. Again, Wolfsburg, being from the Austria, will be outside. I want to see what Feyenoord can do in there, but it's still the two Eastern teams from Moscow and Zagreb that will go. And Hoffenheim, favored now. Jermaine Svestar still probably with the rating. I was surprised that Ghent is losing to Liberec. So I think it will be Hoffenheim and, yeah, one between the Liberec and Svestar. Big picture. Spurs now ahead of Milan, as you could already see here. Then Real Sociedad, I need to get a Sociedad jersey. Arsenal, Leverkusen, Leicester, and then the first Champions League team going in there is PSG. Napoli dropped all the way down to 9th. Big loss for them. But there are a lot more Champions League teams suddenly in there. PSG is a curious case because they lost to Manchester United. Of course, they are now almost odds on to finish third. Not really yet, but you know. Given that they lost an important game at home. So if they go into the Europa League, they might be considered favorites there. Next round of fixtures. Now the latter groups will go first. For me, it's LASK against Ludogorets, of course. Feyenoord against Wolfsburg also looks like a good one, at least from this Austrian here. Granada PAOK will be a difficult game. Real Sociedad Napoli is probably the big game there. Milan plays at home to Sparta, needs to be 3 points. And Lille Celtic, I really like that one. Roma against Sofia, should be an easy game. Molde Rapid, as I said, for this group, that's a huge one. And I think Benfica Standard is also kind of an interesting game. So that was it for the Europa League. Let me know what you watched or any thoughts on the Europa League. Who do you think will win it now? It's very, very early. Give me a thumbs up if you enjoyed this video. Subscribe to my channel if you want to see more, and I will talk to you soon. Bye. If you enjoyed this video, and if you did, here are some videos and playlists that you might enjoy too. Also, please consider subscribing to my channel and hit the little bell icon to get updated whenever something happens in my soccer universe. And with that, have a wonderful day. Bye!